Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this Banque de France virtual seminar. I am Florence Krebs-Zelès, head of Banque de France New York office. This office was created in New York in 1927. We are today sharing a moment in a digital era, a long and bumpy road since the roaring 20s. Today, in the midst of a pandemic, we wanted to offer you the opportunity to virtually meet Banque de France experts in Paris in order to share Banque de France experience and offer an exchange of perspective across the Atlantic. Please to enjoy fully this seminar, maintain your mic and camera on off. In order to optimize your visual, you may change your layout with the button on the right up of your screen. Choose grid to focus on the panelists and check hide the participants with no video on. You may use the chat button on the right down on your screen to ask your questions or share your reactions. We will use them during the discussion. Please be reminded this event is recorded and we will post a replay on our website. This seminar is the first of a series and will focus on digital currency and the opportunities for central banks and the broader economy. For our two panels today, let me introduce you our moderator, Fidel Middleton. He's actively dealing with digital issue in central banking, as he is the chairman of the Digital Monetary Institute of UMFIF, forum well-known to central bankers and official monetary institution. Philippe joined UMFIF 5 years ago and is currently a non-executive director of this forum. He also is a director of Rifle House Capital and a commissioner at the Guernsey Financial Services Commission, the supervisory body for financial sector in Guernsey.
Thank you very much indeed, Florence. Excellent contribution by the governor. I think he, in fact, did it all. And we are going to have an exciting, stimulating, enjoyable debate and seminar. Lots to talk about. And I think the governor set the stage for us absolutely marvelously. There are 130 odd people joining us. Thank you very much from wherever you are, and you are joining us for breakfast in California and for evening drinks in the Far East. So glad to have you all with us. Hope you will get involved. If you do have a question for anybody, if we've got space, please submit it via the chat box facility, and our team will try and get them through to our speakers. But they're not really setting the rule in many ways in terms of the acceleration of debate and indeed experimentation around it. Somebody's got a microphone on, please. We seem to have an echo on the line. Right, good, thank you. A couple of years ago, the only people interested in digital currency tended to wander around with green arrows in their shirt pockets. Now we have governors speaking eloquently and knowledgeably about it. We have 85 central banks around the world in one stage or another of pilot experimentation with digital currency. We have the People's Bank of China launching a massive beta test incorporating millions of citizens, and we have a newly launched digital currency with the sand dollar in the Bahamas. We also have clearly the emergence of cryptocurrencies, both in-game currencies and things like Ethereum and Bitcoin, not to mention a putative new private currency from Diem and from one or two others. So an awful lot happening, and on one side of the debate, there are a lot of advocates for digital currency, those who say that we are now moving into a digital economy which requires a digital currency, central bankers saying we need far more resilience in our payment systems in case of meltdowns. We need a second leg, something to complement cash, that we need to use the abilities of digital currency for things like programmable money, for addressing financial exclusion. And indeed, in many parts of the world, the tax authorities, the police, and indeed the central bankers are extremely enthusiastic about digital currency. So, you know, what's not to like? Well, on the other side of the coin, there are those who argue that digital currency is merely yet another instrument for politicians and central bankers to engage in financial repression. There are those who see it as an assault on individual liberty and as yet more information gathering by the authorities. There are those who see it as discriminatory because certain blocks of citizens can't or won't use it. And there are those who see it as potentially disruptive to the operations of existing commercial and the existing financial infrastructure. So that gives us a tremendous amount to look at today. Our first panel is looking at what are the benefits and brackets, the potential disadvantages of digital currency. I've got a super panel here. My job really is to referee and throw the occasional stone into the pond to create ripples. Otherwise, I shall be distinguishable only by my horrible haircut, for which apologies. In England, we may well be going ahead with vaccinations, but still all the barber shops are closed. Hence, here's me looking like a tramp, for which apologies. So with nothing more further from me, I'm delighted to pass over to Yvan Audenard, who is the Deputy Director General for Financial Stability and Operations at the Banque de France. Yvan, the floor and much else besides is yours.
Thank you, Phil. As reminded by Governor Villeroy de Gallo in his introduction, I believe, digitization in the world of payments is well underway. And essentially, it takes place on the sides of commercial banks. I mean by that the proliferation of electronic wallets, which facilitate retail payments. At the same time, we see that when it comes to point of sale payments and person-to-person payments in the Eurozone, people continue to use mainly cash issued by the central bank. So why would people need a digital currency? Of course, we must acknowledge the frenzy about crypto assets, including stable coins. But in my view, make no mistake, crypto assets do not have legal tender status, at least in Europe, and offer no guarantee of security, convertibility, or value. Conversely, what is rather clear right now is that the underlying technology, DLT, is an interesting advance. So why not use it to build the technical architecture of a digital currency that the central bank would issue itself? In my view, it could help to address four main issues. First one is security. That has been mentioned by the governor. You said it, Philippe. Security by offering a completely secure digital payment solution. And it's secure because it would be central bank money, not private bank money. The second issue is financial inclusion, meaning that we need to ensure access for all citizens to a universal means of payments, even in a digital world. The third question is the issue of lower demand for cash. You mentioned this, Philippe. The goal here would be to issue an additional type of central bank money that could be used for point of sales and P2P payments, not only as a substitute for cash, but also as a complement for online transactions. The fourth issue or objective would be, in my view, monetary sovereignty. That is the need to preserve the central bank's ability to exercise its mandate, its monetary policy mandate, and its financial stability mandate in the face of emerging private crypto assets or foreign central bank digital currencies. I think that in the central banking community at large, we all share these concerns, more or less, I would say. And this is why many central banks indeed are conducting their own experimentations. As you know already, the euro system itself is considering the potential issuance of a digital euro. That would be a claim of consumers on central banks. So it would be a digital euro like euro banknotes, except that it would be digital. And let me also mention that Banque de France is, of course, strongly involved in this preparatory work. But at the same time, here at Banque de France, we believe that a digital euro could be used also for interbank settlements. So not only for retail purposes, but for transactions between banks. And in this approach, a digital euro would be something like today's reserve accounts at the central bank. We have identified two main objectives in this regard. One would be to preserve the fact that wholesale financial transactions are settled in central bank money, that is, in the books of the central banks. I think this has been one of the greatest achievements of the financial system since the great financial crisis. And this is to guarantee settlement finality. And what we see today, I mean, there are experiments, including in the private sector, on that. With the move to DLT, we see a risk that financial market infrastructures like custodians or trading venues cut away from settlement in central bank money. And this is something we believe would be detrimental to the stable functioning of the financial system. So, let's say CBDC, wholesale CBDC, would be a way to avoid such move. The second main objective would be to tackle the remaining inefficiencies. I think this is well acknowledged, the remaining inefficiencies in cross-border payments. And the intuition here would be to link the central bank digital currencies all over the world. But I don't insist here. I think this is more for the second panel. But you see the intuition. So we are carrying out our own program of experimentation on this specific second set of issues. So now let me conclude. I think whatever the use of a possible digital euro, I mean, be it for retail purposes or for wholesale purposes, for the moment, what is important is to understand all potential consequences. I mainly insisted on the benefit, not so much on the drawbacks, but we can come back to this in the question and across the discussion. And I leave it also to the other panelists. But it is about identifying operational modalities that would be best, that would best achieve the expected benefits. We want also to preserve the effectiveness of monetary policy, the stability of the financial system. And it is only after a holistic and rigorous analysis that a decision to launch a digital euro will or will not be taken, most likely around mid-2021. So I stop there. Thank you, Philippe.
Thank you very much, Yvan. You mentioned the Banque de France has run a number of pilot tests around digital currency, particularly around stable coin. You conducted one very interesting experiment around covered bonds. Without disclosing all your secrets, well, I mean, we'd like you to disclose all your secrets, but I presume you won't. What lessons have you learned from the pilot tests that you've carried out so far that you could share with the rest of us?
Thank you, Philippe. To be very clear, I mentioned actually two sets of experimentation. There is the preparatory work, the analysis that are taking place today under the umbrella of the European Central Bank. So that's testing the feasibility of a retail digital euro. And the second set of experimentations I mentioned is the one that are performed by Banque de France itself. So let me then go deeper into both of them. On the first part, I think probably you've seen the speech by Fabio Panetta, who is basically heading this work at the European Central Bank, and where he says that we can agree on the benefits of a digital euro for consumers, but there are a number of potential difficulties. We should take care about the impact on financial intermediation, on, let's say, on the stability of the financial system in normal times, in crisis times, and basically on the ability of the central banks to conduct its monetary policy and to deal with financial stability issues. And he also said that the way to mitigate this risk is about the design of this potential digital euro. So the experimentation are about the design. So we check the feasibility of different technologies. Obviously, DLT is a case in point. But when you think of the digital euro, you also have to think about, let's say, the settlement layer per itself. Here we try to see to which extent we can leverage on existing infrastructures. In the euro area, we already have, for instance, infrastructures for instant payments. So the question is how to leverage, how to maintain the benefits brought by such infrastructures together with the benefits of implementing a DLT, for instance, to issue the currency and to transfer it to the different parties. So this is basically, I don't want to go deeper because obviously, as you mentioned, well, first of all, this work is not completed yet, it's ongoing. But you should be, I think, you should feel reassured because the conclusion will be presented over the spring. So it's not so distant. On the second set of experimentation, that is those who are under the remit of Banque de France, here what we check is the feasibility, well, both the let's say, the interest of having a CBDC completing what we may qualify as the tokenization of financial assets. We see a number of experiments and already actually infrastructures operating based on DLTs. So today, some custodians or some trading venues have the ability to perform their task on a DLT. So the question is how can you perform end-to-end transactions on such platforms, let's say in a seamless way, while still benefiting from the ability to settle in central bank money. If you want to do this today, let's assume that, for instance, you are transacting on a DLT, you issue and you buy securities on the DLT. If you want to settle, you have to, in central bank money, you have to make a connection with the existing systems, let's say the target to system in the Eurozone. The question here is how can you do this without having to recourse to the target to system, but doing it in a single system with a currency that would be also digital? So this is where the digital euro for wholesale purposes comes in. And we are basically testing, making trials on this type of fetches. I think on our list, we have 8 experimentations with a different group of institutions, private sector institutions, obviously. We have already performed 2. And one is about the possibility to settle the issuance of covered bonds on a DLT platform. The second one is about the same idea, settle here the purchase or the transactions on investment fund shares. And these experimentations have been completed, and the conclusion is that it's feasible. It's feasible, so that's I think good news. I mean, very good news indeed. The questions that it raises is the ability, the performance, the ability, the scalability is of these tools. You can do it for a certain number, certain amount of transactions. Can you do it at the scale of the Eurozone, for instance? And these are the remaining questions we need to address.
Thank you, Ivan. That's fascinating. I am very interested in the multiple experiments the Banque de France is doing, and in particular interested by the liaison that you're forming with the private sector in doing it. And of course, one of the things the governor said is that the way in which the public and private sectors are engaged around this is going to be enormously important. Now, after that a very extensive kickoff for us, Yvonne, for which many thanks, I'm going to pass over to a gentleman who's been described as a top 25 crypto lawyer. I'm not quite sure what a crypto lawyer is, whether it's somebody who deals with cryptos or whether it's somebody rather more sinister. But I do know in his previous incarnation, he was also chairman of the CFTC and is now a senior counsel with a major law firm, Wilkie Farr and Gallagher. So I presume he's all right. So with that, I'm delighted to welcome Chris Giancarlo to join us. Chris, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Philip. You know, I want to start with a slightly provocative statement as a former regulator, but also considering that our host today is a major central bank. And that is that the official sector does not have exclusive dominion over money. Money is as much a social construct as it is a government construct. Sir John Cunliffe, the deputy governor of the Bank of England, said to me not too long ago, he says, it seems to him that looking at history, several generations society asks the question, what is money after all? And you know, society has been asking that question over the past 10 years now. It's really driven by a combination of a convergence of a number of technologies, exponential digital technologies like the internet and cryptography and distributed ledger technology and tokenization, but also I believe by social changes since the last financial crisis. And specifically, some degree of loss of confidence in global financial institutions and financial regulation. I say that as a regulator, and really also the stable value of central bank money. So I believe society has actually been way out in front of the official sector in experimenting with money, and the official sector is now working to catch up. You know, we've seen over 3,000 new cryptocurrencies in the last 10 years. And of course, Bitcoin has been leading that charge. First, it was retail investment in Bitcoin, but now institutional activity is rivaling retail activity. And I believe that the launch of regulated and transparent markets for cash and physically settled crypto derivatives by the agency I had the honor to chair, the CFTC, has really led to a real maturation of a non-official sector marketplace for cryptocurrencies. In the case of Bitcoin, it now has over $1 trillion in aggregate value. So as I said, central banks are playing catch up to the private sector when it comes to digital money. And the Banque de France has certainly been a leader in experimenting and been on the front facing mode of looking at this. But still, there is no functioning CBDC to any scale, although China is moving fast. So I believe CBDC has a lot to learn from non-sovereign cryptocurrency. I observe 6 imperatives for central banks to explore CBDC. And the first, I think, was the first mover for China, and that is data capture. China was very concerned about Alipay and AntPay's access to individual financial data. And I think that's also driven some of the EU and the US's concern when they saw Facebook's attempted launch of LibraCoin 2 years ago. I think the second driver is infrastructure modernization. Certainly we see this in Singapore's MAS project Ubin, but also the work of the Banque de France and the BIS Innovation Lab. certainly infrastructure modernization. The third driver, I would say, is financial inclusion. And someone mentioned the Bahamian sand dollar. Many US commentators have been calling for postal banking as a way of assisting financial inclusion. And certainly some efforts in Congress termed a digital dollar was driven toward financial inclusion. A fourth driver has been what I call precision monetary policy application. We certainly saw the US's very ham-fisted attempts at COVID relief that was done in the form of paper checks, over $1 billion of which was issued to people who were deceased, really shows the limitations of an analog monetary policy distribution system and the benefits that might come from a CBDC. The fifth driver, I believe, is geopolitical influence. I certainly think this for countries like China that where their currency is not a primary reserve currency, I think geopolitical influence is important. And that brings me, though, to the sixth driver, reason why I think central banks need to be involved in this, and particularly what central banks of democracies. And I think that is because it's all going to be about influencing the setting of global standards and global protocols, and ultimately the social values. You know, money carries with it social values, and the social values of democracies, of economic privacy balanced against law enforcement, of the rule of law, of free market enterprise. I think those social values, as opposed to social credit and state surveillance of economic activity, are going to be set in the next few years as the global standards of digital money are set. And I think that's a main imperative why Western central banks need to be involved. Anyway, that's why a year ago at Davos in 2020, I announced the formation of the Digital Dollar Project, a not-for-profit enterprise with no commercial interest to advance, partnering with Accenture, a firm that has been working with a number of the world's major central banks on this, but they're participating in the Digital Dollar Project on a pro bono basis. We've got an extraordinary advisory board, and our purpose is to advocate for the U.S. central bank to accelerate its experimentation with CBDC. In May of 2020, we published a white paper introducing what we called our champion model for consideration. Not that it had all the answers, but we thought it was a format for consideration. And that format was a CBDC that was in the form of a tokenized bearer instrument issued by the Federal Reserve, distributed through the existing two-tier banking system and regulated intermediaries. That would balance individual economic privacy against appropriate law enforcement, and that would be monetary policy neutral. And I invite observers today to take a look at that pilot, white paper at digitaldollarproject.org. In September, we proposed 9 pilot programs, I won't go through them at length. I'll just say they look at and underbanked consumers, both in rural and urban areas, also in the area of government benefit distribution. It looks at bank consumers for national usage, looks at the impact of a CBDC on small and medium size non-national business users, SME retail payments, and then also large institutional international payments. And then also at the impact on large market infrastructure players, banks and other large players. And again, I invite you to take a look at those pilots at our website. You know, I began by saying that money is as much a social construct as it is a government construct. And I fully agree with Fed Chairman Powell that advances in digital money will not just come from the official sector, but from the private sector. And that the Digital Dollar Project, we believe that to develop a digital dollar will take the same active cooperation between the private and the public sector that built the space program and that built the internet. Well, right now, the U.S. lacks a sandbox where the private sector and the official sector can engage together to develop these type of pilot programs, these type of pilot projects that look at some of the business, social, societal benefits of CBDC. Well, the Digital Dollar Project believes it can help foster such an environment, and we'll have more to say about that in coming months. Thank you, Philip. Happy to join in the conversation today.
Thank you very much, Chris. It brings a whole new dimension to our discussions, which is very valuable. Can I just throw one question, which some people have said that far from financially exclusive digital currency, in its broader sense, be it fiat or private, is actually exclusionary, because it actually pushes people without access to the banking system even further to the margins of the financial infrastructure. Well, what's your feeling about that?
Well, I actually disagree with that, because mobile devices provide extraordinary on-ramps into financial inclusion. We've seen that with M-Pesa in Africa where other mobile access has been provided. I believe that a central bank digital currency can be a vehicle for financial inclusion. But that's one of the things we need to test out. Financial inclusion is a major issue here in the United States. And I think one of the best reasons for experimenting with central bank digital currency is to test out exactly that, whether it can be a vehicle for greater financial inclusion for a lot of our population.
Thank you. And I'm not sure it'll solve the problem of sending checks to corpses, but maybe the digital ones won't be cashed. That's a very good challenge, and I'm delighted that our next speaker is a man who will be part of responding to the challenge that you've raised. Dave Wells, Associate Director on the Board of Governors of the Fed, and I know he has some very interesting views about financial infrastructure and the role of the public sector in making that of value to the community. So, David, can I pass over to you, please?
Clearly, and hopefully you can hear and see me okay. All right, excellent. So, well, first, thanks to you, Philip, for moderating this, and the Banque de France for putting this together. Always a pleasure to have very important and meaningful conversations about the future of money and payments. And now more than ever is a very important time to be discussing these types of important topics for preparing ourselves for the next generation and beyond. So. Running the risk a little bit of repeating what others have already eloquently said, I think the way I'd like to frame a bit of how I think a bit about central bank digital currencies is across three dimensions. The instrument or the money, the monetary instrument itself, the infrastructure on which that monetary instrument might be transferred, and the entities that support it. And I think, you know, as Chris rightly posed the question, you know, or made the statement about money being a social construct, and there are a lot of different ways to sort of think a bit about the range and types of money that you might see to serve a purpose of making payments, right? We do see both public and private forms of money. And so really the question here is, in terms of the monetary instrument, is what sort of demand use case would you expect to have for a digital version, say, of the US dollar, or any central bank digital currency, as a way to enhance the existing infrastructure and ecosystem that we have? So that kind of gets me to the second point on the infrastructure side. And again, oftentimes, you know, we think of the infrastructure, particularly in the US, is provided both at the public and the private sector when it comes to payments, both wholesale and retail payments. We have a variety of both public and private sector infrastructures that are put in place. And I think a lot of times when we think about use cases, we're often thinking a bit about improving infrastructure or improving the way people can transact in different ways. And so a fundamental question for central bank digital currency is how does the introduction of a new digital monetary instrument improve on existing infrastructures? So again, we have in many of our jurisdictions, we have either near instant payments, or we're moving, in the case of the US, towards a more instant payments platforms. This is providing a lot of enhanced electronic capabilities. So what does a digital dollar, say, or other digital central bank digital currency provide over and above improvements simply in infrastructure? So I think it's fair to ask, where do we get infrastructure improvements versus where we might get improvements from introducing a new type of central bank liability? And then the third sort of area that I think a bit about is in terms of the entities or the institutions that support the infrastructure. And again, you know, there are a lot of references in all the remarks today about you know, the two-tiered banking system, you know, relying on financial institutions, helping them to having them help facilitate the distribution and perhaps transfer of central bank digital currencies is also important. How do we think a bit about the roles of those types of institutions? How can they continue to play a role? How can that anything that a central bank creates in terms of a central bank digital currency avoids disrupting that ecosystem and balance is also important. And so again, a lot of challenging questions. So all that is to say, I think first and foremost, we often think about, at least I often think about central bank digital currencies as how can it provide additional enhancements to payments and payments activity? I think of that first and foremost. And that's where I think the use cases should hold the most promise. The second element where it could maybe enhance things like central bank toolkits, you know, whether it's able, you know, and provides more targeted monetary policy enhancements and things, I think are of second order importance, because none of that will really resonate much if we don't have folks who are interested and want to use a central bank digital currency for a variety of important purposes. And that kind of gets down to the fundamentals of payments. So maybe I'll stop there with my opening remarks. I know we're short on time as it is now, and I'll turn it back over to you, Philip.
No shortage of time for insight and expertise, Dave, and thank you very much indeed. One of the things as a foreigner to the United States, I'd like just to talk to you about is I'm often told that the US dollar is almost an article of faith in the US, and that citizens won't give up the greenback, the physical dollar bill. Do you think that is a major barrier to introducing a digital dollar, at least within the borders of the United States?
So I think, you know, the Fed and as well as other central banks who maybe participated in the BIS work around central bank digital currencies, we issued a report back in October of 2020 on some of the standard issues around central bank digital currency, kind of fall back on a few things. One is particularly about this coexistence, is that I think we all seem to have a collective view that a central bank digital currency is not meant to replace physical cash or replace commercial bank money, but perhaps complement those two types of versions. And so I don't necessarily see, to answer your question more directly, that physical currency and folks' preferences to hold that as an obstacle. I think that that's going to be the case in many jurisdictions, and central banks in that report kind of indicated a commitment to not thinking of this as a replacement for physical cash. And so I feel like that coexistence is going to be present in whatever form a central bank digital currency would take. So I don't see that as much as a barrier. Now, could people's strong preferences for physical cash inhibit its growth and functionality as a central bank digital currency? Perhaps. I think that gets to thinking a bit about where a central bank digital currency can really enhance types of transactions on a digital platform, more person to person would all be sort of enhancements that you might think are possibilities. But again, it all I think depends on the relative proportions.
Thank you. What I find interesting, and I'm not going to pick it up now directly, is there are two schools of thought here. There's a school of thought that says CBDC is complementary to cash. It provides a parallel track to existing system, guarantees financial system resilience, and don't worry, citizen, we're not going to take away your picture of George Washington or your picture of Her Majesty the Queen or your picture of whoever happens to be President of the European Commission this week. There's another school of thought that says, come on guys, cash is inefficient, it's outmoded, it's expensive to produce, it's expensive to distribute, it's expensive to handle, and it promotes crime because criminals can down because it's completely untraceable and so on. Therefore, we're gonna get rid of it. I'll throw that one in there for our panel to think about, because I'm now going to pass to Professor Patricia Mosser, who is Professor of the MPA program at Columbia University, following an exceptional career both at the US Treasury and indeed the New York Fed. And she's written extensively on payment systems, crypto, payment security, and I can't think of anybody better to summarize our debate to date than Patricia. So over to you, Patricia.
Thank you. Good morning. Good afternoon, everyone. I want to thank the Banque de France for including me in this. And let me start by, first of all, agreeing with a lot of the comments that my fellow panelists have said about the benefits of digital currencies, and let me be specifically central bank digital currencies, which is mostly what we've been talking about here, not completely, really do have the opportunity to be a lot more efficient, particularly compared to, bluntly, the current system, which is somewhat cumbersome, to put it nicely, potentially safer. And again, potentially have really significant benefits with respect to financial inclusion in many countries, most particularly in the United States, which has a very large unbanked population. But to realize those benefits and not to incur really large costs and side effects and unintended consequences, shall we say, is going to require, I think, an evolution in how central bank digital currencies fit in the current system. And I agree they need to fit within the current system. I'm definitely evolutionary and not revolutionary in my views on this one. I'm a former central banker and an economist. And so I tend to think about these issues from the framework of monetary economics. I mean, really simple, what's money? Basically, money has two characteristics. One, it's a store of value, and two, it's a means of transaction. And you can't be money if you can't do both those things. And I hear I'm going to echo the governor's earlier remarks too. History tells us that, frankly, there's really the really only truly stable money, stable currencies in all states of the world. Emphasis on all states of the world are those that are backed by sovereign governments. They are fiat currencies. And that's the reason I think the emphasis on central bank digital currencies is right. And it's also the reason that nearly every central bank I know of has this as its first mandate to provide for a stable fiat currency. And central bank digital currencies have to absolutely fit that mandate for sure. Now, right now, as we know, fiat money, abstracting for the moment from bank reserves, which are, you know, of course, the current crude version of a wholesale central bank digital currency, but highly restricted in its way, fiat money is really only physical cash. Plus, if you want to stretch the definition, private money deposits, if you like, that are actually backstopped by government insurance, meaning deposit insurance. And so if you really narrowly think of transactions money that way in many countries, and that's not quite correct, but it's a pretty good approximation, then a central bank digital currencies has to figure out how to fit in that mix. There's one very, very important characteristic that I want to highlight here that several people have alluded to, but I want to be really explicit about it. Private money with a government backstop and physical cash have one very important characteristic. They are pari passu. They trade one for one in all states of the world. It doesn't matter whether times are normal, you're in a financial crisis, you walk up to an ATM at a bank and you pull out cash instantaneously, one for one. Restricting quantities, you can have different prices for those two types of money, but you cannot restrict the conversion between them. And so assuming we don't plan to completely throw out that old system, and that if you want an evolution, that seems right to me. The question is how central bank digital currency should be structured to realize those benefits. Well, it has to trade one for one with bank deposits and physical cash. If it doesn't do that in a crisis as well as in normal times, then it's not going to be money. And it means that accounts need to be structured very carefully, and it has to be priced very carefully. For example, so that in a crisis, the entire banking system isn't disintermediated when everybody converts all of their bank deposits into central bank digital currencies, because there's a flight to safety and liquidity. Setting quantity limits is not going to fly. We just saw an example of that a few years ago with the Reserve Bank of India actually somewhat unintentionally restricting the supply of currency. And it created complete chaos. It's really not the direction that you want to go. If you like, currency, physical cash now by central banks is provided completely elastically at demand, on demand. It just is. You don't restrict the supply. So the question is, how do you structure a central bank digital currency in the sort of macro financial environment to make that work? By the way, in a crisis, a central bank digital currency, in fact, has some pretty interesting implications for lender of last resort. If we think there's going to be a flight to safety from private money into public money, may very well impact both the type and the quantity of lender of last resort that central banks have to do. Let me close with a couple of thoughts about attractiveness, because obviously the story I've just told is very consumer demand driven. Money is a social construct. Consumer preferences are really different in different countries. And I think that's going to heavily influence the fact that perhaps not one size is going to fit all across countries. On privacy, for example, US consumers are incredibly willing to give up their private information to private companies, but a very significant proportion of them have absolutely no interest in giving any information to the government. It's one of the reasons for Christian Carlo's example earlier of people preferring to literally get physical checks and wait because they don't want to give their digital information to the government. In many advanced economies, citizens have exactly the opposite set of preferences. Although I guess in a number of emerging markets, perhaps their consumer preferences are a bit more like those in the US. Mistrust of banks is incredibly high in some countries. So using banks as agents, which is certainly one way to go about central bank digital currencies in some countries could be more problematic than others. Secondly, as a lead in perhaps to the next session on cross-border payments, let me briefly say something about the unique role of the dollar, which a couple of people have alluded to. Right now, US physical currency is $2 trillion. A significant minority of that $2 trillion is actually held by US citizens. And in fact, the share held by US citizens is shrinking because in fact, currency is being replaced by all kinds of private digital payments, means of payments. The vast majority of the US dollars are held outside the US and they are a means of retail transactions and some wholesale transactions and not just the underground economy, but in fact, in normal everyday to-day transactions in lots and lots of countries around the world. The US dollar is the global benchmark currency. Similarly, there's an awful lot of US dollar deposits inside financial institutions in the United States that are held by non-Americans and by non-residents. That's not going to go away, at least not right away, maybe eventually, but it's not going to go away right away. And I am guessing that the central bank is only going to be opening these digital accounts for residents and citizens. Certainly the current proposed legislation in the United States goes that direction. In other words, physical currency is not going to go away, and the trade-offs, at least for non-residents in US dollars, is not going to change that much. And I think it makes, in the United States in particular, setting up a digital currency perhaps a bit more challenging than in others. Let me close by saying that the history of currencies, both private and official sector, is strewn with lots of experimentation. That's why all the wonderful experiments that central banks are doing right now and the sandboxes are such a great idea. But even so, it's not going to be done right the first time, almost for certain. And there will be a lot of adjustments even after central bank digital currencies have gone through their current sandbox phase. I'm guessing there's going to be actual application changes as time goes by. My two cents, I don't think we're going to know how well the central bank digital currencies are actually constructed until we actually have another financial crisis, because how how society and the financial system behaves in normal times is not a very good signal of how it behaves in crises. So I'm guessing this is going to be a long-term adaptation. And on that, I'll stop.
Patricia, thank you. And that was worth an awful lot more than 2 cents. Although I really do hope we don't have to go through yet another financial crisis to sort out what the answer is. Close up to the edge of time almost, but I've unilaterally allowing ourselves a few extra minutes. Ready to come back to you. Either is there anything that you've heard that you'd like to quickly respond to? Or would you like to answer one of the following of the three most common of the multiple questions that have come in? One, is CBDC going to be a threat to financial stability, in particular because it wipes out the payments profits of conventional commercial banking? Secondly, is this all going to go on DLT? And if we are going on to DLT as a technology, will it be a private network, or will the public sector builds its own? And three, how on earth are central banks going to explain all this to their citizens, most of whom don't know the difference between M0 and M1 to start with, never mind anything else? Over to you in order, starting with Yvonne. Pick your question and give us the 30 seconds. Thank you.
Well, this reminds me a line from I think it's John Oliver, the host of the last week tonight show on HBO. He says, cryptocurrencies are what we do not understand about money combined with all what we do not understand about computers. So you see, what we are trying to do is to sort of narrow down the issues, understand a little bit better. And I think Patricia said something very right. She said a lot of things that I fully share, but your last point on the fact that when we will start, if we start, we might not get it right at the beginning. And that's part of it. Think of the introduction of banknotes or production of bank deposits. It didn't work well at the beginning. We had too many, there was crisis, and I don't know. We may be faced with such a situation. So I wouldn't, honestly, I wouldn't try to answer the question. I saw the chat, there are so many. Just let me say the following. What we are doing today is taking step by step. We are experimenting on the feasibility, technical feasibility. DLT is promising. We have legacy systems, and we need to link all this and see how it can work. And the good news is that it looks feasible. Then there are many, many, many questions to address. One is about the design that would indeed prevent a disruptive digital currency. That is the one that would make us lose all the benefits of having today financial stability or efficient monetary policy. And that's the question we face mostly, and that's why we are experimenting. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Yvonne. Whilst you and Patricia sort that out, I'm moving all my assets into gold. Chris?
Philip, I want to respond, if I could, I want to respond to something that you mentioned earlier. You talked about the criminal elements, the criminal access. As someone who ran a regulatory agency that actually put people behind bars for fraud and manipulation of markets, as long as there's going to be finance in any form, whether that's analog or digital, there will be a criminal element. There's criminal activity in paper fiat, there's criminal activity in bank money, and there will be criminal activity in digital currency. It's a red herring to say that's a reason not to proceed. It's a reason to proceed, I would say, because we need to address the criminal element, which really brings us down to the ultimate point I wanted to make, and that is that the balance between economic privacy and law enforcement in a digital construct is about design choices. You can have a system that is fully transparent to regulators in order to weed out criminality, And yet you now destroyed economic privacy. And so as we experiment with central bank digital currency, and I mentioned before the importance of values, getting that balance right and putting the right value on economic privacy for our citizens in a Western democratic tradition is going to be the critical issue, and balancing that against appropriate law enforcement activities. And I think one of the reasons why experimentation is so important is because ultimately I think the society that gets that balance right and other values embedded in money right are going to be the society that's going to have a very successful and functional digital currency. And a society that gets that balance wrong is going to struggle. And I think that's the critical issues, balancing privacy against law enforcement rights, as well as other values like the rule of law, about free markets and aspirational notions of using money for betterment. And these are the issues that I think we need to be very cautious about, careful about, and deliberate about as we go forward in experimenting with CBDC in a democratic tradition.
Thank you. I think it's an important insight. David, can I pass to you, please? Final thoughts?
Sure. So maybe in response to the question is, would a CBDC be on a distributed ledger? And I'd say, I think it's too soon to say how it might be designed in any particular way, because I think, as Chris was just mentioning, there are a lot of design choices that one needs to consider, a number of trade-offs and policy of competing policy objectives that need to be addressed. And I think a lot of that would ultimately sort of help sharpen the kind of design features a central bank digital currency might have. And it's too early, I think, to suppose the one direction over another. And I'd also echo a little bit of Chris's sentiments as well about the need for experimentation helps us open the doors and see the range of possibilities and different technological approaches to some of these more difficult sort of policy trade-offs we have to think through. So thank you.
Thank you. And again, Patricia, falls to you to summarize, if you can, please.
I'm not sure I'm capable of doing that, but I am going to, I will take on one comment here, since I spent some time in my, one of the questions that was posed, since I spent some time talking about, we're not really going to know how well a central bank digital currency works until, unfortunately, we have a crisis. There's a comment in the chat box about citizens not understanding the difference between private bank money and central bank money. In normal times, they don't always pay that much attention. Trust me, in a crisis, they know exactly what is guaranteed by the government and exactly what is not. And I'm not talking about big banks and investors here. I'm talking about citizens. All one has to do is look at the behavior of insured deposits in basically every advanced economy I can think of, not to mention the demand for currency when you have a financial crisis. They do know the difference, at least when it matters. And that's one of the reasons for my earlier comment about I don't think we're going to completely have this all test driven until we have some bumpiness. Thank you again.
Thank you, Patricia. Well, thank you very much to the panel, Yvonne, Chris, David, Patricia. You've kicked us off to a flying start. Wonderful debate. We could go on for a lot longer, but I'm being yelled at by senior people in the Walter Falls to say now is the time to. Thank you all very much. We're going to take a 3-minute break, during which you'll be able to admire the shabby interior decorating of the Banque de France. And then we will resume with panel 2, which is looking at cross-border issues of digital currency.